March 19, 2024 meeting of Lakewood Regional High School Board of Education to order. Please stand for the high school.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, to the republic which stands on our nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Public Meetings Act Statement, New Jersey Open Public Meetings Law was enacted to ensure the right of the public to have advance notice of and to attend the meetings of public bodies at which any business affecting their interests is discussed or acted upon. In accordance with the provisions of the Act, the Board of Education has caused notice of this meeting to be published by having the date, time, and place thereof posted at the Augusta, Branchville, and Sussex post offices, and notice sent to the New Jersey Herald, the Sunday Herald, and the clerk of the boroughs of Branchville and Sussex and townships of Frankfort, Lafayette, and Wantage. Mission statement. High Point Regional High School, in partnership with staff, family, and community, is dedicated to the quest for individual excellence. By fostering high standards of achievement, we prepare students to become responsible and productive members of a diverse society. May I ask for a roll call?
Ms. Cadonis is not here. Mr. Comfort.
Here.
Ms. Wise is not here. Ms. Ireland is not here. Ms. Palisak.
Here.
Ms. Schumann.
Here.
Ms. Orsi.
Here.
Mr. Dunn.
Here.
We have a form.
Okay. On our agenda, we are going to proceed to executive session at this point, but we are actually going to have Ms. Kelly Mitchell, our field service rep from New Jersey School Boards, conduct some training in ethics for school officials, and I think we're going to proceed into the CSA evaluation as well. If that's okay, or
are you ready?
Then we're fine, and we'll just.
Shouldn't have said that.
Yes.
That you didn't want to.
I need to put you on the spot.
No, I can do it, but I don't have anything.
That's fine. Well, I think that works best for us as well, so we can just go through the we're not rushing.
Yeah, so we can do the CSA evaluation and the board evaluation processes together. It's usually a combined training, and I can send you a link ahead of time to do the board self-evaluation, and then we can chat about that, and that builds upon building goals for next year. So that might be something that you want to do. So today we're going to talk about ethics, and that you're obligated every year by mandate to have a discussion on ethics every year. So we're going to have this presentation, and during the presentation, we're going to go around the room and review the tenets of coach ethics and talk a little bit about each tenet and what that looks like. So we'll be doing that shortly, and that'll be the discussion component of the presentation. So as a disclaimer, this is for informational purposes only. If there was any specific situation that an ethics violation came up or a thought process of complaint, you would speak to your board attorney according to your policy in your manual there. So when we talk about ethics, we talk about accountability. They kind of go hand in hand. So the code of ethics really helps us stay in our being and understand our being as board members. A lot of times, especially with newer board members, and sometimes with also new board members, they think that their role is one thing, and they kind of go outside that lane. So the code of ethics really speaks to that, and it keeps us in that lane and moving the district forward in a proper manner. So we are going to talk about different codes of conduct today and what that looks like. This is the actual ethics, school ethics act, and it talks about, a violation of trust, of the public trust, and what it looks like when a justifiable impression is created. So a lot of times we see that often in regard to social media and things like that. So we're going to talk about social media today because that has been a huge issue with the ethics commission. We're seeing an uptick in those violations with that. So we're going to talk about that trust of the public and respect and confidence of the people. So today we're going to go over the School Ethics Commission, the Prohibited Acts, the mandatory training, the Code of Ethics itself, and then those fund disclosures that we all have. we talk about who's accountable. So as board members, we're accountable for all four aspects: the disclosure, the prohibited acts, and the mandatory training and the code of ethics. But then there are school officials, and that includes myself as a New Jersey school board staff, that do have to abide by that prohibited acts. We have to be mindful of that, and we still do have to fill out those disclosures. So what does the Ethics Commission look like? It's 9 members. They serve for 3 years. There's 2 school board members, 5 non-school officials, and 2 school administrators. And it is nonpartisan, so that you keep that in mind as well. So the School Ethics Act has 2 jurisdictions. So it's 2 components. One is the advisory opinions, and then one is ethics complaints. So the advisory opinion is any school official could request one of those. So one of you all could just say, you know, based on an activity of our board here or another board, would that constitute a violation of the act? So there's advisory opinions. And then normally we have about 35% for each year. And then we move on to the ethics complaints, and anybody, even members of the community, could put in for an ethics complaint and possible alleging a violation. And there's about 85 of those every year, but we are seeing an uptick in that. So the mandatory training, this is new that new board members have to have that done within a 90-day period. So are there any new board members? And you did, are you done with yours already?
Governance one.
Yeah, great. So governance one can be done self-paced, live virtual, or in person. And then the second year, you would go on to governance two, which is the finance component. The third year, you would go on to three, and student achievement piece. And then any time you were re-elected or reappointed, you would do the governance four, and that's legal function. Now, if you wanted to, because you wanted to learn more about student achievement or about finance, and you weren't in that year, you can still take those, but you just wouldn't get credit for them unless they were in the year they were in. But you can take them at any time. Any questions on that? So it's really important that we can take some on time, so you all have until the end of the calendar year for this, except for new board members. They have to have that done by April 7th.
Is that a reading change?
Yes, yes, last year. Mm-hmm. We just changed those disclosures that we have to fill out, a new board member has to have those done within 30 days, and then everybody else has to have them in by April 30th. There is a little bit of a change on how to put your data in, so just be mindful of that. When you add your data, it's best to put it all in and then save it as a PDF before you try to email it out, because otherwise you're constantly filling it out and you're saying, you know what, I had that done, I did it, and it loses everything. So once you put all the data in, save it as a PDF, you're best off doing it that way. Does anybody have any questions about the filling out those disclosures? Have you all had your email prompted you to do it? We'll talk about the penalties here. So a reprimand is when you did have a violation, but it was a low level, and it's basically giving you a letter and saying, you know what, don't do that yet. That would be a reprimand. But then it moves on to a censure, and that is where you're going to get a letter that is read at a public meeting, and then it is posted on the website, the school website, for 30 days. So that's a little bit more tougher, and you know, a little bit tougher on the situation. Then you move on to a suspension for something a little bit larger. For example, we just had a recent suspension of 6 months for a board member who thought it was a good idea to do a blog. And he had all the proper disclaimers and things like that. He talked poorly about a faculty member. So that was a direct violation, and therefore 6 months he was suspended for. the Code of Ethics. And just before we do, let's just pay attention to the standards, and we don't need to read that. But when you look at each tenant, there's a standard underneath that. And that's actually what the commission will say, okay, is there factual evidence to this? And when you read through the standard, it'll speak to what that violation would be, and that's how they come to the conclusion whether it is a violation or not. So, Wayne, if you could start with the letter A, and then we'll just talk about what each tenant looks like.
Okay. Code of Ethics for School Board Members A, I will uphold and enforce all laws, rules, and regulations of the State Board of Education and court orders pertaining to schools. Desired changes shall be brought about only through legal and ethical procedures.
Okay, so letter A is actually what we did when we took our oath. That is in there. And we do need to uphold and enforce all laws, rules, and regulations. We have to be mindful of that. We saw an uptick in violations of that when boards were going against some of the state health standards. I know that's a tough situation, but it was a mandate, and we needed to do that. So we were seeing an uptick in violation when it came to that. So just be mindful that when we're voting, that we have to uphold the laws, rules, and regulations.
I will make decisions in terms of the educational welfare of children and will seek to develop and maintain public schools that meet the individual needs of all children regardless of their ability, race, creed, sex, or social standing.
Right, so then we're thinking about our work at the board table. We're thinking about all students. It's very important that we're very inclusive of all students and not just looking at certain components of the district. So that is what should be guiding us when we're making those decisions. Good.
I will confine my board actions to policy meeting plans and as a result, and I will help to frame policy and plans only after the board has consulted with those who will be affected by them.
So this is a really good example of what our needs. So a lot of times board members think that it's the right idea to roll up our sleeves and get in the mix, but it's really not. It's that oversight piece, and this speaks to it. So it's policy, planning, and appraisal. So the appraisal would be the CSA evaluation, planning would be budget as a board member, that oversight of the budget, things like that, goals, district goals and board goals. And then of course we policy. So that's really it. That's our goal as board members. A lot of times board members think that it's something other than that, but it's actually our main. So I really like letter C because it really defines what our goal is.
D. I'll carry out my responsibility not to admit to the schools, but together with my fellow board members to see that they are well run.
Right, so this D speaks to that piece of oversight, how we should have that 30,000 feet in the air type of view that we're in the blimp, we're looking down, and we're seeing just that oversight piece instead of being down on the dance floor and saying, like, oh, this person needs to move over here and we need to move this over there. So this gives a really good example of what our site should be, is that oversight.
I will recognize that authority rests with the Board of Education and will make no personal promises or take any private action that may compromise the board.
Yeah, so E really speaks to a lot of different things, but we're seeing an uptick in that. And what's happening with letter E is board members are having a hard time going from campaign mode to being an actual board member. And you have to understand that as a board member, your authority rests as a full board. Individual board members have no authority. So what happens is a lot of times, a special interest group or what have you will send you sideways and want you to, do any type of personal promises or kind of work as an individual. And you can't do that because you don't have that authority to do that. Your power is within the team itself and the full board as a whole.
I will refuse to surrender my independent judgment
confidential in all matters pertaining to the school, which, if disclosed, would needlessly injure individuals or the schools. In all other matters, I will provide accurate information, and in concert with my fellow board members, interpret to the staff the aspirations of the community for its school.
So what the case speaks a lot to executive, and I have to be mindful of what executive is really there for. There's only a couple of different aspects that you speak to in executive itself, and they do need to remain confidential. But be mindful that when you are an executive, if something doesn't fit into those buckets, you really need to make sure that you have it out as a board table in public, because those discussions are really important, you know, on the audience, open documents. So be careful of that, and also that confidentiality piece goes hand in hand with executive, but it also goes hand in hand sometimes with committee discussions, where you're having a discussion as a committee, and then you have embedded it as a full board, but sometimes if those committee discussions get leaked out into the public, it can be hurtful to the full board or the district because you haven't embedded it as a collective group yet. So just be careful with those conversations out in the public too about committee meetings as well.
So this is part of the code of ethics, but quite honestly, I mean, there could be legal issues with this one that are more dire than just violating the code of ethics, right?
Oh, yeah. Definitely. So, you know, anything confidential or maybe a faculty member or not, you could have a lawsuit against the district if that comes out. A lot of times people think, like, well, I'm just talking to my spouse about it. It's not a big deal. We're just having a conversation. But it has to stay within those walls. And it's really super important. And then also, sometimes when we're in executive, we start conversations that move along out in the public discussion. So just be mindful of that too, because things that don't belong in executive really need the public needs to see that discussion. So that's really important as well. So a lot of times those lines get a little blurred up during executive.
I will vote to appoint the best qualified personnel available under consideration of the recommendation of the Chief Administrative Officer.
Right, so when we see a violation of each, it's usually when a board member will go out to a member of the community and say, you know, we're going to have this availability in this role, and I think you'd be great for it. I'll recommend it to the board member. Well, we don't have that authority. We have to rely on our superintendent to recommend any faculty or staff, and then based on his or her recommendation, we would go ahead and vote. So just be mindful of that, that is the role of the superintendent.
All right. I was important to protect school personnel and proper performance of their duties.
Okay, so this speaks to that man with law, right? So he spoke poorly about all the personnel, and we hire qualified personnel, and we should support them in their duties. So if you're unhappy with something that went on in the district, it might be appropriate for you to discuss that out in public, and we should support our personnel. So.
Jay, refer all complaints to the Chief Administrative Officer and will act on the complaints at public meetings only after failure of an administrative solution.
Okay, so Jay really speaks to that whole supermarket piece, right? So you're out in the supermarket and a member of the public comes up to you and is really frustrated with something that's going on in the district. And you were lucky to, you know, be part of the public and be the public voice. happens when we think about the failure of administrative solution isn't really a failure. We're just not happy with the decision. So just be mindful of that when you're speaking to the public, because you wouldn't want to set them on a course that wasn't proper. So chain of command is really important, and Jay really speaks to that. So thank you so much for that discussion. I appreciate it. Does anybody have any thoughts on any of the tenants?
Like the guy you mentioned with the blog, he made a comment about a teacher. He can't make a comment. Who can make a comment? A public can make a comment.
Yeah, so that talk piece, and we're going to speak to that a little bit later, but the talk piece was that he was speaking poorly about the faculty, but it seemed like it was in an official capacity. So if he was speaking as just a member of the public, that's one thing, but when it's perceived that you're speaking in your official capacity, then that would be a violation. So we're going to talk about what that content looks like on social media piece.
But in that case, you mentioned the little disclaimers.
Right, so however, but you can put this disclaimer, we're going to see what this disclaimer looks like in a minute. But when you put that disclaimer up and then you speak in your official capacity, then it kind of negates this claim. So that's exactly what he did. He put the disclaimer up, said, I'm speaking as a private citizen, but then he went on to talk like a board member. We did this, and we said that, and we voted this way, and we're not happy with his faculty. So then you're kind of skewing that whole disclaimer saying that you're speaking as a private citizen. So social media is a really tricky you're a board member. You have to remember you were elected, so a lot of times people realize that you're a board member and you have not the capacity to speak to the full board because you don't have that authority.
So you should have the right to speak as an individual.
You do. You have the First Amendment right, absolutely, but only as a private citizen. So there's ways to.
How do you differentiate between the two?
Yeah, so you put this disclaimer, we're going to talk about the disclaimer. And then you can make sure that anything that you're posting from is just a personal page, that there's nothing on there that would identify you as a board member. Sometimes people have like a private Facebook page, but then in some place in there they have, you know, being sworn in, or they have like board member somewhere on there that you just can't have that.
It just seems to be catch 22, because if you're voted as a public figure, a public figure that's voted in outside of a board can't do all that.
As a matter of fact, if you think about it, town council doesn't abide by a code of ethics. We're really the only one that has a code of ethics for our board. So it's a tricky situation. So we'll talk about that social media piece in a few minutes, but I see what you're saying, and it is frustrating because you do have your First Amendment rights, but it kind of gets a little diminished because of that situation. So here's some examples of that letter E that I said with the uptick of that. We don't need to read through these, but I just want you to take a look at the lower one that talks about using your board email. Be careful when you use your board email, because that does give the appearance that you're speaking in your official capacity. So when you email, like let's say you email a member of the public, they contact you, you email back, make sure that you're not speaking for the full board or not. Make sure that it's something that's just chain of command based, something like that, because you can have a violation based on that. And you would never use your board email to go outside, as far as like a good example, if you were unhappy with mask mandates and then you emailed all the members of the public and said, you know, you need to do this, you need to go to the Congress or what have you without the mask mandate. By using your official email from the board,
and it shows that you're speaking in capacity of a full board, and you have a mental violation. So just be careful in that type of situation. Again, some cases that came about for the letter being impact. So then we move on to contributed acts, and that's part of the ethics acts. And that speaks more to making sure that you recuse yourself from anything that would benefit you or your immediate family. So it speaks to that conflict of interest, that financial gain, that favor that you would be getting. Let's say you had, as a board member, you owned a construction company. If there was any discussion at the board table that possible use of your construction company, you should have no discussion and no voting as a board member on that. So any type of financial gain there. And so if you notice the word recuse instead of abstain, this is new guidance from the Ethics Commission saying that if you have a legal conflict, that you should recuse yourself from the discussion and the vote, not abstain. So you should only use abstain if you don't have enough data to make a decision. That's the only time you should really abstain. You used to use that as, if you had a conflict, you just abstain. But if you didn't have it, you're still at the table having the discussion, and then you abstain. So if you were part of that discussion, you could really be skewing that vote. So the new guidance is that you would recuse yourself from the discussion and the vote, and then move on. When you use that extension, it can skew the tally too of the vote. So this is new guidance, and everybody kind of gives me a look like a jersey.
No, I have a question.
Yeah.
When you say recusal, how would that be executed? Would you, when you got the agenda item, declare that I must recuse myself and then leave the room until such time as that is over with? Is that how I would do that?
So you wouldn't have to leave the room per se, but maybe you would just remove yourself from the table, come over here, just sit quietly, and then once it was done, then you would go back.
Or just don't add it to the conversation.
They said that a total refusal from the whole situation would be to remove yourself from the table. That was the guidance there.
So, unfortunately, that's the first rule here in this.
Yeah.
And although I consider you an authority, I think that you would need to hear something that comes from our court attorney.
Yes, and that's what I said to you. Yeah. This is for informational purposes only. But if you did have any specifics, you should ask your court attorney. That's the annual, right? So that's super important. But this is the new guidance that we were told from the Ethics Commission. We just hired somebody from the Ethics Commission to actually be the counsel for us at New Jersey School Boards. And she was the one that actually did this slot and said that this is really the time. So I know it feels a little uncomfortable, but if you think about it, if you did have subject matter that in a way that you spoke to, but then you abstained, but during the discussion you spoke to it, you could be guiding the board in the direction of both one way or the other, right, for that discussion. So the recusal is the way to go. But definitely to speak to your attorney about that. Just so everybody knows, everybody gives me this little comment that I've been talking. I'm ready for it.
I heard it last week because I wasn't here this week. I was prepared.
So, relationship definitions, I put this in your packet, so it really speaks to exactly who is a immediate family member and who's a relative. So, it's good to just be mindful of that. And then, this actually came from an advisory opinion just recently in November, and it really drills down to beautiful nuances of relationships that you have and possible conflicts. So I put that into your packet so that you can really see if you were conflicted or not. But that came from an advisory opinion because a lot of times what was happening is they didn't know if you were conflicted or not based on different relationships. So they decided to make a table like this so that you could easily take out. work in the district, this gives you guidance on how to conduct yourself, anything that touches the superintendent, you have to be mindful of that. Collective bargaining, this is a really great tool to understand if you participate in negotiations and if you can vote to ratify. So I put this in your packet because I think that is a really good thing to understand who you and what you can be in negotiations. Sometimes workers feel like, well, I can just come in and speak to the VA and the superintendent. just because you put that there that you're speaking as a private citizen, but then you speak like you're a board member, or you have something on that page that identifies you as that, then that would be a clear violation. So just be careful with that. You have your First Amendment rights. You're able to speak on social media, certainly, but you just have to really be careful about that content. And then also make sure that when you are posting, you're not posting from a site that has anything to do with your campaign. A lot of times we have Facebook pages that are pulled from these type of campaign pages. Once you're done with campaigning, shut that page down so that you're not tempted to post from there, because that would give the impression that you're speaking in your official capacity and not as private. And then checking like on posts, definitely do that from your private personal page, and just be mindful that if it's something that you speak to at the board table, you might want to shy away from checking like on that because you want somebody who thinks that about something that you would have been endorsing. And then divisive language, of course, anytime that you post any language that you wouldn't be using at the board table, you probably want to do that. So just a point to consider, anybody that's contributed, you might want to just put a little tablet together and just have it handy so that nobody makes a mistake or going on things that they shouldn't. And then you get an email all the time that from school board notes. That gives you an update on all the advisories and any type of things to do with ethics. So the ethics commission expects you to do that. And you open it up, please. So make sure that you open that up and you go up. If you need, then we can help you with the guidance on course of action. And that's it. Thank you so much for having me in. Is there any other questions for us? Well, thank you so much. And I guess we'll chat later, ma'am. I'm going to do anything else.
Yes, thank you. Okay, with our training now completed, we will make a motion to enter executive session to provide an update on legal personnel and negotiations items which are exempt from public participation pursuant to New Jersey Public Law 1975, Chapter 231, Open Public Meetings Act. Any discussions held by the board, which need not remain confidential, will be made public when appropriate. Minutes of the executive session will not be disclosed until the need for confidentiality no longer exists. The board will reconvene in public session in person and virtually at the conclusion of the executive session. It is not anticipated that any action will be taken. Typically, we reconvene at 7 o'clock so that we can let the public know when to be available. Because of our training session, it's very possible that our executive session may go beyond 7 p.m. But we'll do our best not to inconvenience the public. Try to get back as soon as possible. So, I'll make that motion.
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay. back in closed session. Turning to our agenda, we have no unfinished business, so approval of minutes, regular meeting minutes, February 27, 2024, and the executive session minutes of February 27, 2024. I'll make the motion to accept. Have a second?
Second.
Any comments, corrections?
Mr. Donovan?
Abstain.
Mr. Conklin?
Yes.
Ms. Wise?
Abstain.
Ms. Palsy?
Yes.
Ms. Shirley?
Yes.
Ms. Orsi?
Yes.
Mr. Donovan?
Yes. Motion carries. Okay. Public comments, agenda items only. In accordance with the Open Public Meetings Act, we will open for public comments for agenda items only at this time. Each speaker should state his or her name and address. We will have 3 minutes to address the board, which will be timed by the board president and myself. We will limit this section to no longer than 45 minutes. Please be respectful and mindful that your comments are being recorded. And as always, we have two meetings to make public comments, one at our podium here in person, and two is via our virtual platform to the email address that's listed on that platform. Nothing virtual? Okay, may I have a motion to close public comments?
Motion. Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, we'll move to presentations. First, Ms. Emma Whistle, Speaker of the House, update on student council.
So we've had a lot going on in student council, just talking about and getting stuff ready. So we're starting
is self-discipline, is a paradigm for March, so that will give back. And that's a really important aspect of just our own recognition, self-reflection of that. So a lot of student activities that I'd really like to report on, just to give you some updates of where things are at. In addition to student council, we've had some busy activities from our SAFE students, with Students Against Violence Everywhere, one of our most engaged clubs, and we have some members that are sitting here as well. And they had a lot of activities over lunch the last week or so for what we call Say Something Week, which is a national recognition practice in the round four, which is to notify adults that something's going on, just to talk and communicate about things that you do see, and just have this trust with adults in your life. When you get school or outside of school, you make sure you make them aware. So I'm proud of what they were doing during your lunch activities. FBLA, Future Business Leaders of America, they just returned from their state conference. They had a fantastic experience. Thank you to Mrs. Emma and Mrs. Carr, who tracked down the Lake City to take them down there for that experience. They had a chance to have presentations and workshops, and just have an overall great experience with being housed in this camp, which is sometimes a very unique opportunity for a lot of them as well. A lot of art awards are recognized, and I'll try to do my best with all that for this this month. Faith Postma and Rebecca Kiros, both of them have their work selected for their art educators in New Jersey. They often say A, A, J. Sometimes you see that around the building, actually. And they were selected for the NJ PAC spring exhibit, which will be later on, NJ PAC down in the Trenton area. So we need to see two of our students' work there, like you see split behind you. This is all from around the state. Our visual arts students were recognized at the 37th annual Olive Invitational. They do an art invitational each year as well in this competition. So Kate Marches took home first place in the sculpture category. Sophie Tessman and Dave Ridley were also awarded generous scholarships if they choose to attend the Warren College of Art and Design. So again, not only recognition for the boards, but also a scholarship as well that they choose to go to more college or apologize on that. Thank you to all of our teachers for their work with those students on a regular basis. Think about Casey, who you're going to hear from a little bit later on. Teen Arts at SCCC. Last week, fantastic opportunity for our students. I wanted to publicly thank SCCC and all their coordination for allowing us to be on the campus of all the county schools. So it's a lot of buses, a lot of kids, a lot of coordination. So it's a fantastic job. We had over 70 students contribute work in that. And that was a really great day. They have artwork, we had singing, we had music, we had dancing, we had media, all about. It was just really neat to walk the campus on a beautiful day and see our students engaging in workshops, seeing our students engaging in poetry, seeing students engaging in dance or media, or singing, like war planning, and the jazz ensemble. So it was a little bit of everything besides the endless amount of artwork that was displayed as well. A couple of students I just want to recognize that were kind of recognized at the Teen Arts, and then we move on to what they do is they recognize the Teen Arts level, and they may then go to a county designation. They may just like to have their artwork recognized and shown in like a courthouse, so it's a county, or larger down in Trent, or larger for state level concerts. So it's kind of like the beginning of that. We have creative writing prose, Violet Baker from Mrs. Strout, creative writing prose, Claire Doctor from Mrs. Strout, creative writing poetry from Scott Craig, Mrs. Strout, creative writing poetry, Devin Brotman from Mrs. Strout as well. I had a chance to actually be in a workshop that Mrs. Strout led, and it was basically a poetry chance for students to be able to speak about that. So I heard three of those share their poetry. It takes a lot to get in front of individuals and say and speak about your own work, and they did a fantastic job with that. In addition, we had dance, Olivia Taller, Mrs. Shimas, she was recognized as well. Filmmaking, Ultimate, Old Fonts by Isabel Aslan Walker, which was advanced in media tech class, was also recognized. So you can see a broad spectrum of different types of creativity. I just wanted to thank Mrs. Myers, Mrs. Shimas, Mr. Sack, Mr. Dierhoff, Mr. Carroll, Mrs. Martin, Mrs. McCarty, Mr. Slaney, as well as Mrs. Levansky, Mrs. Strout, for not only coordinating the trip, which takes a lot, but also just making sure that the students get a chance to be recognized for where their passion is. And it's really probably the most important thing to take away from Teen Arts, is everybody has a chance to shine in their own capacity. Someone would be on stage dancing, and that's awesome, right? That's great. Who's them? Give like Olivia a lot of credit. And someone who just had a hard work displayed. And it gives them both a chance to be recognized. So thank you to both them and also Mr. McCarthy, who did a lot of work behind the scenes on that. That wraps up a little bit of the art recognition. Tomorrow we have our career and college fair. Our results and postings up around the board, around the buildings we walk in. We're excited about that. We have about almost 20 employers coming here. I'm really focusing a lot, especially the last couple of years, Chicano and myself, the guidance department, trying to make sure that we explore as many careers as possible too. As we have Emma sitting here with her Eastern shirt on, that's really important. And we want to make sure that we acknowledge and recognize and give them a chance for that. But having a chance for careers is really important too. So we have many local partnerships coming into High Point to do some small breakout workshops with our students or also to speak to them in a broader setting. So we're really excited about that. Some are High Point alumni, some are not. Some are local, small businesses, some are a little bit larger. So I think it's a really important aspect that there's a pathway to career for everybody. We also have all of our military branches represented as well. That's about 50 colleges. So it's going to be a busy cafeteria, annex, media center, but we're excited about having that buzz right now. So thank you to Mr. Fazier, Mrs. Finicario, and Mrs. Meyer for really coordinating that. It takes a lot of work and effort to get that done and get the all the arts pointing in the right direction. For that 2-hour window is really, really impressive. Last and certainly not least, we have Young Frankenstein this weekend. If you're interested in coming out for a lovely musical, I promise you will not be disappointed. I've never seen one in my entire life that would be disappointed. I really believe that they are at a level that is right below professional. People say that all the time, and they see that from other areas. So Young Frankenstein this weekend, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. Friday night, 7 o'clock. Saturday night, 7 o'clock. And Sunday at 2 o'clock. So we're looking for a fantastic aspect of the show. Mr. McCarthy did a great job. The students are exhausted. This is tech week. And they're trying to get through to their... So their excitement is different. As I talk to them, they're like, they're just going through the motions, they're trying to get there, and then all of a sudden it's up at night, they're diverging. But it's a lot of work. They're working Saturdays, they're working Sundays, they're working until 10 o'clock at night, and later. So it's a tremendous time to take for sure. And our schedule bill for 24-25 is fast and furious underway. We're working with God and CST. Ms. Delaney is putting that fantastic endeavor. And we're looking to build the best master schedule that we can to support our students' passion and their focus. Okay, Mr. Nava, I switch over a little bit to some athletics. Mr. Jackson provided me a couple key updates, something you may have heard in the small group, but Ella Flitter was our state champion, girls' state champion. We're really excited about that. You probably saw that posted already on our social media, so we're excited about her run. She's a freshman, and it was a pretty, pretty intense final match that she was able to capture at 138 pounds. She wrestled an individual that she had wrestled for six times this year, so they were basically ranked number one or two in the state. And they paired off against each other six times, so that's really hard. Ella came out four out of six times and won the state championship. Literally, the last 2 seconds, had a reverse, took down for 2 points, and won the match. So it was a pretty cool thing. And she's about as humble as they come. Talking to her afterwards, she's pretty cool. She missed one day of practice, but not really, because she went late to practice the next day. So. She really didn't miss much at all. We also had Nick Clayton, who was able to make the regions and lost in the third round of SFACs, but congratulations to him as well. And it is a large game to get through those things. And then I just wanted to make sure I come back to a couple things. Kate talked about before as being a pretty good artist, right? Recognized at a level with the Malala competition. He is also our greater Morris County scholar athlete. That program is run through a program out of Morris County, and they choose Sussex County, Morris County, and Warren County students, and they put them all football players at that high academic standards, high community service standards, and high athletic achievements. They all go in the same room together, and they bring the parents, the coaches, and the families, and whoever else can come to that event. It's really nice. So it's put on by the greater Morris County area, sponsored actually by things like Oak Creek Institute and the Jets. So, Kate will be on Thursday for that selection as well. Now, I would be remiss if I didn't mention that my daughter, Addison, was also selected for the Fast Along Scout Athlete, which really a nice event. I don't want to get too emotional and start crying, but it was a really nice event to go to and see all of our sisters' family for their school. It was a chance to nominate somebody. And they did a fantastic job with the community service project. They did a unified basketball tournament at Hackensack High School. Had six different teams from the county, and they completely did it on their own. And that was really one of the best music that I've seen the past couple of months. It was really, really neat to see that outcome, to see the joy of the students engaging in that activity. It was pretty special takeaway. So it was nice. I just want to say congratulations officially to Madison, also known as my brother. A lot of information. I'm sorry for that. Any questions that you may have? Any of that?
Next up, Mr. James Campbell.
Good evening. Cross off Madison, there are no challenges. Congratulations, he's a great representative. Spring is the time for one of many wonderful things, including testing. Some we kind of relish, the AP testing, some we aren't as excited about. We have the GPA graduation proficiency assessment. We have the PSAT 10, we have the NJSLA in May, and the first of those took place last week, and it was really smooth. To be able to test 200 juniors in one wing and keep them away from the rest of the school, the rest of the school to have their classes, not have the bell schedule disrupted, made it for a very manageable experience. The students took it seriously, the staff was extremely supportive. My administrative assistant, Ms. Jessica Briggs, she could lead an infantry division into battle. Organization was tremendous. So it's a lot of work to execute these assessments, and we want the students to be comfortable and for the school not to feel overwhelmed by the process, and I think we really succeeded in that. So that was good. I also want to mention the College and Career Fair tomorrow. Our guidance department has also arranged probably six different trips where they're bringing students who are interested to trade schools and to work sites to see firsthand what post-high school experiences could look like if they're not directed or
intending to go to a two-year, four-year college. So we're really excited. We have a diverse group of students, and I think we're doing a better job increasingly at preparing them for a variety of post-high school options. So tomorrow should be a lot of fun. If any of you are interested, let us know. We'd love to have you come in and check out the college and career for them. Tomorrow is staff meeting, and at that meeting we will continue our conversation on instruction. One of the district's goals, as I mentioned before, and obviously this board approved them, is for the administration to do 1,000 classroom visits. And we continue to do these visits. Lately, we've had teachers accompanying us on the visits. We're doing more of them tomorrow. And it's really just been nice to talk about at the heart of what teachers do, which is to teach and instruct, to measure learning, to assess, to reflect on how to get better and better. And I think we're trying to be more collaborative in that effort. Today I sent out a slideshow of just four or five classrooms that I saw today. Just some incredible things. I just picked one period, walked through rooms. Off the top of my head, Heather Stroud had a classroom where they were all seated in a horseshoe. And at the end of the class, her closing was to open the floor up and allow her students to give a shout out and applaud students in the class who they thought did a really good job commenting on the literature that they were reading. So you kind of see the students take ownership and the way the teachers empower them and build that classroom culture where the kids want to raise their hand and want to cite one another's excellence. I walked across the hall in Jessica Struggles' classroom, and the students were reading the hypothetical essays that they created, taking on the character of a Civil War civilian or soldier and writing to a loved one. And public speaking is difficult. The students got up and they read this emotional, heartfelt, creative piece of art, which was great. And he had them all hung up on the wall. One student, I think, was perhaps uncomfortable, and so to affirm that Mr. Strell read it for the student. I went up to the science lab. This Sunday, her one of the best lessons we do at High Point is her forensics end of the semester activity, where the students engage in a real forensics investigative exercise, and they were doing handwriting analysis. So the classrooms are alive, and there's just great stuff going on. So we're excited about that. Often here, when I speak, I commend the board and thank you for your generous support of the Field Trips High Point offers. Our students go to more places than any students anywhere. They have tremendous opportunities to go to great places. But lately, we've been bringing tremendous resources here on site and adding virtual field trips. Just today, in the Media Center, Michael Patrick O'Neill, a world-renowned author and marine biologist and photographer from Brazil, all day long presented his celebrated award-winning photographs of wildlife, and it was really captivating for the students. Last week, the Sussex County Prosecutor's Office was in, and we brought in our true crime literature class and our street law social studies class and had them engage with local detectives. Yesterday, Mary Beth Tinker, the name rings a bell, Tinker v. Des Moines, is one of the most influential First Amendment cases in American history. Mary Beth Tinker, when she was 13, her and her four siblings wore black armbands in 1969 to protest the Vietnam War. And at the time, such student expression was really looked frowned upon. And they were suspended for having worn the armband. And their case was picked up and brought to the Supreme Court, and they won. And Tinker stands today as a really seminal case on student rights and the First Amendment. So she was here virtually for 2 hours explaining to our students what it was like to be at the forefront of the civil rights movement and what her thoughts were on current student rights, et cetera. So that was really, you know, great stuff. It was great stuff happening, and it's exciting to walk around and see what's going on. I'd also like to thank Mr. Dunn and the Sussex County School Board Association It was an honor 3 weeks ago, perhaps, to host the first annual Unsung Hero Award. And it's special. I think one of the things that High Point embraces is being a place that welcomes newcomers and welcomes guests. And I think when the entire county came here, they felt welcome and they felt special. And it was a wonderful night. So to see students from grades, it was grades 5 through grades 12. Nolan World was our honoree, who has done amazing things and raised money for our food pantry and other charities. So it was a great night. Thank you, Mr. Dutta, to the School Board Association for.
Thank you all for attending and the support that you had.
Yeah.
It was a great event.
Great night. Any questions about it?
How many students did the off-site tech training thing with counselors?
I would say maybe I had 5 trips. One trip may have had 8 kids. One trip may have had 24 kids. So it's a rolling series of trips. Some sizable attendance, some modest.
Is it all grades?
Ish.
Missed grades.
Missed grades? Yeah. Thanks. So we're trying to celebrate everybody's path and make sure that they're given guidance and encouragement.
Okay, that's it for presentations. We have an item under other business. I guess it didn't fit into action items. So the one item under other business is a recommendation by the superintendent that the board approves the revised memorandum of agreement between education and law enforcement officials reviewed for the 2023-2024 school year, along with the Article 12 affirmation, which can be viewed at the link. I'll make that motion. May I have a second? Any discussion, comments on that item? Okay, have a roll call.
Mr. Comfort?
Yes.
Ms. Watts?
Yes.
Ms. Palsek?
Yes.
Ms. Schumann?
Yes.
Ms. Orsi?
Yes.
Ms. Donovan?
Yes.
Mr. Dunn?
Yes. Oh, moving on to action items under curriculum instruction and technology.
Okay. So items 1 through 3 are faculty attendance for February, student attendance for February, and the suspension report for February. Just draw your attention to that. There are attachments for each of those. And I'd like to move items 4 and 5 together. 4 is the recommendation to approve field trips. And there's an attachment and the recommendation to approve professional development activities with an attachment. Making a motion to second. Second. Any discussion? Please roll call.
Ms. Wise?
Yes.
Ms. Palsek?
Yes.
Ms. Schumann?
Yes.
Ms. Orsi?
Yes.
Ms. Tadonan?
Yes.
Ms. Comfort?
Yes.
Ms. Tadonan?
Yes.
Personnel, Mrs. Tadonan, any votes?
Yep, I'm going to move items 1 through 5. 1 through 3 are right here on the agenda, and then there are 2 on the addendum. So item 1 is the recommendation to accept and regret the retirement notification of James Lukowitz. Item 2 is the recommendation to approve Matthew Lavar as a substitute teacher for the remainder of the 23-24 school year and receive all required paperwork. Number 3 is the recommendation to accept the resignation of Ms. Katie Goodman as Tech Teacher of Science effective June 30th, 2024. Item 4 is a recommendation to approve the extended medical leave of absence for employee 205 as listed. And 5 is a recommendation to approve the following 6 period assignments at the per diem rate as listed. For April 8th through May 20th, or until permanent employment is released back to work. So a permanent employee is released back to work. Make a motion seeking a second.
Second.
Any discussion?
I would like to congratulate Jim and wish you the best of luck in retirement. I'm a little envious, but I wish you the best and enjoy your time.
Sure. Thank you for your job with Jim.
Thank you. I work closely with Mr. Minkowitz. And in his 2 stints here at High Point, and I was
hoping the second would extend a little bit longer, but I don't resent your decision at all to jump on retirement as you're able. And thank you for everything you've given us, and we'll see you a little bit later tonight, a budget that was put together, and look forward to a lot of hard work from yourself and your office. And thank you for everything you've done.
Thank you.
Congratulations. I will personally miss you very much, and I appreciate all the opportunities we've had to work together.
Thank you.
Good luck.
Yes, a roll call.
Ms. Schumann?
Yes.
Ms. Orsi?
Yes.
Ms. Padona?
Yes.
Mr. Comfort?
Yes.
Ms. Wise?
Yes.
Ms. Palsek?
Yes.
Mr. Dunn?
Yes. Anybody want to take it?
Sure.
That's on the line.
Yeah. So I'd like to make a motion for number one, as recommended the approval of individuals listed below the unified track aides effective March 19th, 2024. For the 2024 school year, at their regular hourly rate, time sheets must be submitted for payment as listed. Making a motion, see me a second.
Second.
Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Ms. Orsi?
Yes.
Ms. Padona?
Yes.
Mr. Comfort?
Yes.
Ms. Wise?
Yes.
Ms. Palsek?
Yes.
Ms. Schumann?
Yes.
Ms. Padona?
Yes. We have no policy or negotiations items, action items, under buildings and grounds. Anyone want to take buildings and grounds from the buildings and grounds committee? Mr. Conklin, thank you.
Side one and two together. It's recommended that the Board of Education approves the execution and delivery of a grant agreement for the design and replacement of the 13 unit ventilators for group heating and cooling. It's recommended that the Board of Education approves the delegation authority to the school business administrator for supervision of the school facilities project design replacement of the 13 ventilators. Any motions in the second?
Second.
Any discussion? Roll call.
Ms. Wise?
Yes.
Ms. Palsek?
Yes.
Ms. Schumann?
Yes.
Ms. Orsi?
Yes.
Mr. Dunn?
Yes.
Mr. Comfort?
Yes.
Mr. Dunn?
Yes. Let's see what I can do here. I'd like to move item 25 together. One is a recommendation to accept the report of the Board Secretary and Business Administrator for the month of February 2024. And two is a recommendation to accept the report of the Treasurer for the month of February 2024. And three is a recommendation to approve the report of transfers and minimum expense transfer report for the month of February 2024. And four is a recommendation to approve a payment, the tax schedule of audited bills dated March 19, 2024. And item five, the recommendation is the Board accepts the adult education agency account, athletic account, cafeteria account, principal's petty cash account, scholarship account, school store account, and school activities reconciliations for the month of February 2024. I will make that motion. Have a second.
Second.
Any discussion or comments on motion five? See none.
Ms. Palsek?
Yes.
Ms. Schumann?
Yes.
Ms. Orsi?
Yes.
Mr. Dunn?
Yes.
Mr. Comfort?
Yes.
Ms. Wise?
Yes.
Mr. Dunn?
Yes. Item six, the recommendation the Board approves and authorizes the execution of a contract between High Point Regional High School and Porzio Compliance Services for the period from March 20th, 2024 to the final school day of the 2023-2024 school year. The contract is for investigative consulting services related to the harassment, intimidation, and bullying investigations for the district for the remainder of the school year at a cost of $12,500. I will make that motion. May I have a second?
Second.
Any discussion or comments on that? Action item? Okay. Seeing none, roll call please.
Ms. Schumann?
Yes.
Ms. Forsey?
Yes.
Mr. Dolan?
Yes.
Mr. Comfort?
Yes.
Ms. Wise?
Yes.
Ms. Palsek?
No.
Mr. Dunn?
Yes.
Motion carries.
And I'd like to move item seven, which is a recommendation of the Board acknowledges and gratefully accepts a donation from a meal for a meal, the Worthy family, in the amount of $3,500 to replenish our food pantries. I'll make that motion. May I have a second?
Thank you.
Any comments?
Just to thank the Worthy family. very much.
Yeah, to tie this in with what Mr. Campbell was speaking with before, this is now this a meal for a meal is being conducted by Nolan Worthy, who was our unsung hero nominee. So just an example of how an unsung hero has already given back, and his family has given back to the community. It's tremendous what they've raised in the last number of years through this organization. So we thank you to the Worthy family, to the Nolan, for their hard work and their generosity.
Ms. Arson?
Yes.
Ms. DeMillan?
Yes.
Ms. Comfort?
Yes.
Ms. Wise?
Yes.
Ms. Palsack?
Yes.
Ms. Schoon?
Yes.
Ms. Dunn?
Yes. Okay. Number eight is a resolution that the board approves the adoption of the tentative school budget for the 2024-2025 school year as follows. The first section related to travel and related expense reimbursement. I'm not going to read that in its entirety. That extends through the paragraphs, that last paragraph that goes to the next page. It recognizes a maximum expenditure of $7,500 for all staff and board members. For travel expenses for all staff and board members. So next, on to the adoption of the budget. I will read this in its entirety. Being resolved that the budget be approved for the 2024-2025 school year using the 2024-2025 state aid figures, and the secretary to the High Point Regional High School Board of Education be authorized to submit the following budget to the Executive County Superintendent of Schools. In the table there shows the general fund numbers, special revenue, debt service, and total. The important number here that most people want to hear is the taxes to be raised for the general fund, both under the general fund and in total, $17,851,193. Be it resolved that the High Point Regional High School Board of Education approves the levy of general fund taxes for the 2024-2025 school budget to be $17,851,193. This budget addresses health and safety issues related to facility, capital spending, student-centered items, and program integrity, and to advertise said budget in the New Jersey Herald in accordance with the form suggested by the State Department of Education and according to law. I will make that motion. May I have a second?
Second.
Any discussion?
Did we get a state aid figure?
Yes. It was discussed in finance. I'm not actually sure.
It's 188,000 more than we received last year.
Okay.
We were,
yeah.
First time, 7 years.
7 years.
Yeah, we weren't.
Okay.
I'm sorry, that didn't cut you off. Do you have anything?
No, that's, I'm curious about the cut.
That's the 1.75% on the tax levy increase and 1.65% increase on the general.
We're permitted by statute to increase the tax levy by 2% without having to go to vote or to consult with.
You kept it below that.
Yeah, well, not just kept it below, but we were able to provide something less than that minimum. In recognition that, some money should be returned to the taxpayers, as we were able to see that. We have, this was the sixth or seventh year of projected state aid cuts. We were anticipating to be cut, however, not an extremely high amount like we had. They've already lost so much over the previous years. I wish anybody knew how those numbers are calculated, because state aid figures, it just seems like they pull them out of the air, and you only know once the
amount of knowledge that comes out from the state, and I guess we were pleased. So again, in recognition of that we weren't cut as we were in the past, we were attempting to try to reduce some of that. So, pardon everyone, I usually make the same statement every year of the budget, that I consider the vote on the school budget one of the most important, if not the most important thing that a school board member does in the course of their year. So, I don't take it lightly. I know many of us, well, we all live in the community, we're all, you know, subject to the same taxes, and we're very sensitive to any unnecessary increases. I believe what Mr. Minkowitz and Dr. Ripley have put forward as a budget year addresses, like I said, a number of very important needs. Does not, I think Dr. Ripley is proud of this, we have not had to reduce force during our state aid cuts because we have been so fastidious in the finances. So I'm going to support the budget, just not second in advance of the vote. And again, I think it's an important vote, and nobody will feel the same way.
I would like to congratulate Jim. It's an excellent budget that you put together.
If no other comments, Mr. Dunn?
Yes.
Mr. Conforth?
Yes.
Ms. Wise?
Yes.
Ms. Palsek?
Yes.
Ms. Schumann?
Yes.
Ms. Orsi?
Yes.
Mr. Dunn?
Yes. Okay. If I may then move items 9 through 13, the 13 on the addendum together. 9 is a recommendation to approve direct mission to the High Point Football Camp, William Percy, to host the non-affiliated COVID camp ages 7 to 14, which will run June 18th, 19th, 20th, and 21st. The information as listed is self-supporting. Number 10 is a recommendation to grant permission to the Boys and Girls Wrestling Camp, William Smith, to host the non-affiliated COVID camp rates K through 8. Running June 24th through 28th, as listed. Again, that is also self-supporting. Item 11 is a recommendation to approve an agreement between the High Point Regional High School Board of Education and J&B Therapy, LLC, to provide occupational, physical, and or speech therapy as needed for the 2024-2025 school year. And 12 is a recommendation to approve the application for the New Jersey Department of Education's Teacher Climate and Culture Innovation Grant for the subsequent acceptance of funds should they be awarded. And item 13 is a recommendation to approve and authorize the execution of the following tuition contracts between High Point Regional High School's Ascending and the following districts and related information if they are as listed. So I'll make that motion. May I have a second?
Second.
Any discussion? And roll call on 9 through 13.
Mr. Conforth?
Yes.
Ms. Wise?
Yes.
Ms. Palsek?
Yes.
Ms. Schumann?
Yes.
Ms. Orsi?
Yes.
Mr. Dunn?
Yes.
Mr. Dunn?
Yes. Okay. And transportation. Anybody want to enter transportation?
I can do it if you want.
Yes,
you can. I don't know. Okay.
Transportation, we are going to move items 1 through 11. One is a recommendation to approve and authorize execution of the following joint transportation agreement for 2023-2024. Item 2 is a recommendation to approve and authorize execution of the following quoted contract awarded to the only quote for 2023-2024 school year. 3 is a recommendation approve and authorize execution of the following revised joint transportation agreement, 2023-2024 school year. And 4 is a recommendation to approve a joint transportation agreement between High Point Regional High School and Walk Hill Valley Regional High School for anticipated transfer services during 2024-2025 school year with a 5% administrative fee. And 5 is a recommendation to
approve a joint transportation agreement between High Point and Lafayette Township Elementary School. Same year, same 5% administration fee. And six is a recommendation to approve a joint transportation agreement with High Point and Susquehanna Regional School. Same year, same administration fee. Item seven is a recommendation to approve joint transportation agreement between High Point and Frankfort Township Elementary School. Same year, same 5% administration fee. And eight is a recommendation to approve the resolution for participation in joint transportation agreement between Walk Hill Valley Special Services School District and High Point Regional High School for 2024-2025 school year with a 4.5% administration fee. Nine is a recommendation to approve the resolution for participation in joint transportation agreement between Sussex County Regional Transportation Cooperative and High Point Regional for 2024-2025 school year with a 4% administration fee. And item 10 is a recommendation to approve a resolution for participation in joint transportation agreement between Sussex County Regional Transportation Cooperative and High Point Regional High School for the 2024-2025 school year, as it was listed there, for a 2% administration fee. I guess there's slight differences in what's covered in those two. Item 11 is a recommendation to approve a resolution for participation in joint transportation agreement between Sussex County Regional Transportation Cooperative, High Point Regional, for athletic and field trips for 2024-2025 school year with a 4% administration fee. Subtle differences between those last two. So I'll make that motion, my response to number 11. Can I have a second?
Second.
Any comments?
Well done.
Need a drink of water. And roll call, please.
Ms. Wise?
Yes.
Ms. Palczak?
Yes.
Ms. Schumann?
Yes.
Ms. Orsi?
Yes.
Ms. Tadona?
Yes.
Mr. Comfort?
Yes.
Mr. Dunn?
Yes. We have no legal and correspondence, miscellaneous, and the item. So let's move to our public comments. Same rules apply as prior stated. Please state your name and address. Each speaker should, you'll have 3 minutes to address the board, which will be timed by myself. We will limit this section to 1 to 45 minutes. Please be respectful and mindful that your comments are being recorded. We invite the public either to our podium here in person or virtual, to our virtual platform. Paula.
My name is Paula Fetterman. Each and every one of you were informed by letter of two incidences that we have here at High Point. The one I won't talk about will let the police in the prosecutor's office deal with that. The other one, our superintendent feels that he can do what he wants to do and get away with it. He put something in my daughter's file that is incorrect. I also sent you guys a letter. You forwarded that to him, who's chosen not to do anything about it. So at this time, if any of you can go to a job and get away with putting a mistake in a file of something that's important to me and my child, then so be it, because I don't know of anybody who can do that. He should be forced to either do his job correctly, don't do it at all. I am calling for his resignation tonight, and if he does not correct the stuff that is incorrect in my child's file, this isn't the last you'll be hearing from me. You, as his boss, should either make sure that it's corrected or he leaves. It's wrong. You can't go to work tomorrow and do the same thing that he's being away from doing. She can't. He can't. None of you can. So why is he being allowed to do it? Again, I also asked for his stopping harassing me in emails, because today was ridiculous what he did. And you knew exactly what he was doing. It's wrong.
Then you're making some accusations.
I'm making accusations.
Any other comments? Any other public comments? Can I have a motion to close the public comments?
Motion.
In a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Any non-committee board member reports or comments?
I give you guys kudos for putting up that because you have something as a parent. I am.
And the public comment section is closed. Sorry.
Kudos.
Thank you.
Mr. President, I went to the Sussex County Ed Services budget meeting, and it was really good, no issues, and it looked like they had a very stable budget for the upcoming year.
Great, thank you for attending.
No.
We don't have anything in other business. Oh, well, yeah, all right. So in other business, under the Open Public Records Act, where we go, just one over request we received that's listed as listed.
We received a request for all, a report of all of our purchase orders, and every school in Sussex County received the same.
More than each of.
We're good. Free marketing. With that, may I have a motion to adjourn?
Motion.
What would happen if we all voted no against Jim?
May I have a motion to adjourn?
Motion.
In a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? We are adjourned.